Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Baseballogy, where we look at the current Hall of Famers and talk about their credentials for induction in the Hall of Fame. As always, I don't advocate for anyone's removal from the Hall of Fame, but I do like talking about the history of the game and ranking these players. Have you ever read the book A Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens? It's an excellent book about the lead-up to the French Revolution and the horrors that would begin. It has one of the most famous opening lines of all time. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. And represents the duality and complexity of the era. So why do I bring up this book when talking about baseball? Well, during the 1970s, the line captures the Hall of Fame voting quite beautifully. The 1970s saw the baseball writers induct legendary players like Willie Mays, Mickey Mantle, Yogi Berra, and Ernie Banks. The decade also saw the induction of the first Negro League players in the Hall of Fame, such as Satchel Paige, Josh Gibson, and Buck Leonard, so they had their rightful place among the elites. But it also saw several terrible picks by the Veterans Committee, like Freddie Lindstrom, due to the magic of the Frisch and Terry Coalition. Lindstrom's just the second player that we've covered so far that was inducted by both Frisch and Terry, but there are plenty more on the way. Lindy manned third base, mostly for the Giants, from 1924 to 1936, with stops at Pittsburgh, Chicago's North Side, and Brooklyn before retiring. In all, he hit 311, 351, 449, which was good for a WRC plus of 109. He collected 103 home runs in his career, which might seem like a lot, considering that he's the third player we've covered so far who broke 100. But he also picked up 301 doubles and 81 triples. Lindstrom drove in 100 or more runs twice in his career, leading to a grand total of 779, and scored nearly 900 runs as well. All of Lindstrom's numbers look pretty good, so what's the problem here? Well, it comes down to the same two issues that keep cropping up so far: injuries and pure effect. After his first seven seasons, Lindstrom was a well above average hitter with a 116 WRC+, and it's possible that had he maintained that level, with his strong defensive capabilities at the time, he would have been a lock for the Hall of Fame. Unfortunately, in 1931, he broke his leg and began suffering from back spasms, which caused him to shift from third base to the outfield. He would have one more solid season after breaking his leg, but most of the time he was barely above replacement level until his 1936 retirement. It's fair to say that his injuries prevented him from reaching the heights that he seemed destined to achieve. The pure effect with Lindstrom isn't necessarily due to any particular players, even though there were several hitters miles better than he was at the time, even on his own team, like Mel Ott and, ironically enough, Bill Terry. No, the problem is the era was a great hitter's era, with the average player hitting 291 during Lindstrom's career. When adjusting for era, a lot of his career numbers lose their luster. Freddie Lindstrom was a decent player, but certainly not one of the all-time greats. Thanks for checking out today's video on Freddie Lindstrom. What do you guys think about his selection? Let me know in the comments below. If you liked what you saw, please click the like and subscribe buttons to get updates on when the next video comes out. Also in the comments, you can try to guess who the next video is going to be about. And here's your hint. This player was the right fielder for the Giants before Mel Ott, and died tragically young due to a kidney disease. That's all for this time, and I'll see you next time.